All right. I want you to look with me just real quickly at Mark chapter 8. If I left that text on there, that's my mistake. It's Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Now, it should be, what is the text that comes after that? Is it Mark 8? Okay, all right, good. Mark 8, 31 to 38. Now, remember that if you back up a little bit, verse 16, they began discussing with one another the fact they had no bread. So they're, we told you that, you know, just use your imagination, being in the boat with the bread of life and saying, we don't have anything, we have no bread. It shows you how dull even the brightest, even the most exposed to privilege and to light can be. And we told you last time also, a couple of weeks ago now, that it wasn't until 10 months before the end of his ministry on this earth that he began to really press upon them the challenge of giving up everything. So what you have in the gospel is that salvation by grace through faith is free. You can't purchase it. You and I can't do anything to earn it. We can't put ourselves in a position where we become worthy of it. So salvation by grace through faith is free. However, discipleship is costly. And this is where he begins to press this. And we're going to look at some of those passages tonight. Mark 8, 31 to 38. Now stand with me if you would while I read this. And if you don't have your Bible, you can follow along on the screen. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. Now we've just gone over this recently in our study on Mark on Sunday mornings, but I want you to hear it more specifically in the context of this challenge to follow him day by day. And he said this plainly. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, but turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." That's critical. We're going to be looking tonight at how we need to learn to think like Jesus. Calling to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels." What we just read together tonight. We've read the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. Help us, Lord, to understand what we've read, to be gripped by it. We talked about this morning, to be transformed by it. Thank you. Please be seated. When you just let the text speak, here's what happens in this passage. Jesus turns up the heat. He began to teach them, which means he's going to repeat this, he's going to teach it over. Now we've seen this in Mark where he says it and he states it again. When you piece the Gospels together, particularly Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we've told you before, those are called the Synoptic Gospels. It's S-Y-N-O-P-T-I-C. It simply means the Gospel, the three Gospels seen together. That's literally what it means. And you lay them side by side. You see these recurring, at this point in his ministry, these recurring intensifications of his impending death. He lays it out. And verse 32 tells us, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. We know from Matthew's gospel and Luke's, that a little bit of what Jesus, what Peter said to him, no, Lord, this is not going to happen. Nobody's going to lay a hand on you. And what is Peter doing? You would want to commend Peter and say, isn't it wonderful that Peter, one of the disciples of Jesus, was really concerned about Jesus' welfare and pledged himself not to let Jesus' welfare come under pressure or harm. But Jesus in this text says, turning and seeing his disciples, he rebukes Peter. One writer says, isn't it fascinating that Peter goes in this section from being the first one to declare Jesus as the Messiah to the first one who gets rebuked for wanting to superimpose his will on God's will. He rebukes him. He says, get behind me, Satan, for you are not, here's the deal, you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Now, hang on to that. There's a lot that's been written and taught, and I've taught a lot of things that are not wrong about self-denial. For example, self-denial comes in the arena, it happens in two stages. The first area of denying yourself is to turn from sin to God. That's a work of the Spirit in regeneration whereby you turn. It's part of repentance too. Repentance is a change of mind where you don't justify your thinking and your sin anymore, but you agree with God's mind on what it is. So it happens at conversion. It's a new way of thinking, a new way of acting, a new way of speaking. But then as you grow in the Christian life, self-denial is in the arena. You could say, sure, you battle against sin, you put to death remaining sin, and so in that regard you're denying yourself somewhat. But really, self-denial also happens in the area of things that you could rightfully claim as your own. Things that you could reasonably and legitimately make a case for, and yet for the greater good and glory of God, you deny yourself. Dawson Trotman. Any of you familiar with Dawson Trotman? He was the founder of the Navigators. Navigators have had a great impact. One of our writers, Jerry Bridges, whose books we've studied since I've been here, was a big leader in the Navigators. He died a year or so ago now. Dawson Trotman said, others may, I cannot. It's a classic thought pattern of self-denial. Others may, I cannot. But here in this passage, I want you to see specifically, contextually, what Jesus is talking about when he begins to teach. Notice he says to Peter, you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself. Let's go back and look at Peter's situation. Peter's thought process was on the things of man. It was thinking the way men think and not thinking the way that God thinks, not learning to do that. One of the things a disciple's got to do, a follower of Christ, he's got to learn to think like Jesus. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And so this whole idea of self-denial, originally Jesus speaking to anyone who would follow him, is change your thinking. Change your thinking. The more we learn to think like Jesus, to think what we call kingdom thinking, the more obvious following him becomes. And here's what he does. He says, okay, deny yourself, take up your cross, follow me. There's the call to discipleship. But notice what he says next. For whoever would save his life will lose it. Now, if we drill down into what Peter said, That's not even quoted here in Mark. It's from the other gospel accounts, but it provokes a response from Jesus, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, your thinking, Peter, is satanic. Now, that doesn't mean that Peter was thinking like a demon. What he's doing is he's thinking worldly. Who is the god of this world according to the scriptures? Satan is. Jesus turns the normal thought process on its head. It's called the irony of the gospel. Whoever would save his life will lose it. If we make life about protecting ourselves, then we lose life in its significance. But whoever loses his life, whoever comes to the mindset being taught by the Spirit to think like the Savior, whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. But what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? This is not a verse that is adversarial to the accumulation of wealth. Barnabas, I've told you before, as best we can tell from the New Testament, Barnabas, one of the key figures, the son of encouragement, he was called, had wealth. But his wealth did not have a higher place in his thought process than his desire to be a follower of Jesus Christ. So his wealth was submitted to that. The rich young ruler, contrarywise, his wealth was more important to him than submitting, cultivating a thinking process like the rabbi that he approached and said, "What good thing must I do to have eternal life?" You know, the contrast right there. You have the rich young ruler who is exactly what he's talking about. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? And then you have Barnabas that shows that you can have, under God's providence and his kindness, you can have wealth and yet not own you. You be a steward of it. For what can a man give in return for his soul? Verse 37. Who can put value on a soul? It's interesting, folks. You know, we can put a lot of value on a lot of things. You can have appraisals on this and appraisals on that and estimates of the value of this and estimates of the value of that. But when you come to the eternal soul, you cannot assign value to it because it is part of the fancy Latin term. It's the imago Dei. It's the image of God. It is the part of us that is eternal. That even when our bodies, when our physical bodies wear out and die, our soul will never die, the scripture teaches. And our bodies will be raised in the resurrection in a new body, a glorified body. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, this mortal must put on immortality. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul teaches us there at the end of that. So when this corruptible is put on incorruption, this mortal is put on immortality, then will be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. But the soul never dies. The body will be renewed and glorified to give a proper habitation for the eternal soul in eternity. What can a man give in return for his soul? And the questions are asked in such a way that the answer that's expected is nothing. There's nothing more valuable than my soul. Nothing more valuable than your soul. Of all the things that are within the sphere of the reach of your life, nothing has the value, even compares to the value. Even though God made everything, He's the creator of everything, the fact that we are made in the image of God, that our souls are that part of us that enable us to communicate with our Creator and our Redeemer. Remember that everything he's saying here now is really a teaching moment in response to what Peter says when he tries to stop Jesus from pursuing this path that he mentions in verse 31. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes. That's pretty well, that's the Judaistic system right there. And be killed. It's not just suffering. Be killed. The Son of Man must be executed by the Jewish leaders, is what he's saying there. After 3 days, rise again. Everything he says, when he speaks to Peter personally, when he calls the crowd to him in verse 34, and continues, is in response to. So we get to verse 38. For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation. We talked about this morning. I think we can all agree we live in an adulterous and sinful generation. And that's not to say that other generations have not been that way. It's just an honest admission of where we live right now. Whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. What he's done here, folks, is he has said, the path to my exaltation goes through the path of suffering and death. In Peter's human way of thinking, he wanted to see Jesus exalted, but he had an altogether different path in mind for Jesus to take. And we've talked about this before through the years. You've studied this. You know this. There was a mindset in Judaism that taught that Messiah would either be one person who would come together and bring together the attraction of the military might of the people of God and the attraction of the religious devotion of the people of God, or it could be two people, one a military commander, one a priestly type, who would together lead the people and subdue the enemies of God. That's why some commentators have suggested that when John the Baptist sends word to Jesus, John the Baptist wants to know, are you the one to come, or should we look for another? He may have been asking, is there just going to be one of you or two of you? That was Peter's mentality. That the path to exaltation of Jesus, the rabbi, whom Peter declared, you are the Christ, you're the Christos, you're the anointed, you are the word Christos in the Greek is the same word as Messias in the Hebrew. You are the Messiah, he said. The Son of the living God. And in Peter's thinking like men, the Messiah coming meant ascendancy, rule, domination, subduing the enemies, exalting the people of God. Jesus says no. It is suffering and death. And notice verse 38, when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. That the goal, the desire Peter had was going to be accomplished, but not the path. And so Paul would learn this in Romans 8 and say, we are heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we, what? Suffer with him, that we might be glorified together with him. Thinking like Jesus. Let's just read some other passages and we'll probably get into this thinking like Jesus some more. Look at Luke 9, 22 to 25. He said, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. And he said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow me. Same thing, I just want you to see how it crops up. For whoever would save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? And then later on, in that same chapter of Luke, chapter 9, verses 57 to 62. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said, well, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. To another he said, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go bury my father. And Jesus said, leave the dead to bury their own dead. These seem like harsh terms but from our Lord, but they're not so much harsh as they are striking. They're designed to check us in our thinking like men think. and showing us we need to learn to think like Jesus. We don't come to this matter automatically thinking like Jesus. One preacher said, this stuff does not grow on Adam's vine. It's when we're saved, we have to learn to think not like Adam, but learn to think like the second Adam, because we all come into this world thinking like Adam. Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Yet another said, I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home. Jesus said, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Then move farther in Luke's gospel, chapter 14, verse 25. Now great crowds accompanied him. He turned and said to them, we've said this before. If you want to find some of Jesus' most piercing teachings, find a big crowd. John chapter 6 is a fine example of that. When he finished the John chapter 6 bread of life discourse, the crowd that had followed him said, this is a hard saying. Who can bear it? Who can handle it? Verse 26, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Those words have caused no small amount of controversy. I remember my friend David Miller, one of the great preachers. He struggled with muscular atrophy most of his adult life, which means his muscles just go into a state of disuse, unuse. And when I heard him preach the first time, he had to be helped up on the platform in a wheelchair. He had to be brought in his wheelchair and helped to stand up. He could still stand up at that point. He can't do that anymore. He could not use his arms. And he had his sermon memorized. And he would read his text, having it memorized it, and preach his message. It was the most powerful preaching I've ever heard in my life. And he was preaching out of Malachi. Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. Remember that passage? And he goes into this long, he's from Arkansas, so he's got this Arkansas drawl. Now, brethren, there are men in this room who have degrees that I don't have. There are men in this room who have capacity of the Hebrew that I'll never have. He goes on and on about it. He said, and they could do it. They could show us the nuances of the Hebrew word for love and the Hebrew word for hated, and on and on. He said, so I don't have their learning. He said, but can we not agree that whatever love means and whatever hate means, they don't mean the same thing? It was profound. Pointedly, simply profound. So rather than get bound up, how could Jesus say this? I mean, isn't Jesus pro-family? Doesn't he want someone to honor the fifth commandment, to love, to honor father and mother? How could he say, hate father and mother? Wouldn't Jesus teach in such a way that Paul would write later that husbands love your wives as Christ loved the church? That's missing the point when you get bogged down in that. Jesus is using language to press us to the edge and force us to ask ourselves, do I think like Jesus thinks? He's not giving anyone an excuse to be hateful to parents, to be hateful to his wife, to be hateful to children, to be hateful to siblings, or even to have a self-loathing, self-deprecating attitude toward his own life. What he is saying is that his requirement to follow him requires a love so complete, so intense, so comprehensive, so focused, that by comparison, you could call the relationship you have with family hate. Scripture doesn't contradict itself. We said that this morning. It's an analogy of faith. Scripture interprets Scripture, and it does not contradict itself. So we know he's not advocating a cult of hate. He's not giving permission to anyone to hate any human being. He is saying here, as he goes in verse 26, whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Remember now. People have said to him earlier in Luke, and he's just seizing upon this, I'll follow you on this condition. I'll follow you if I'll follow you when, or I'll follow you as long as. And Jesus says, no, there are no conditions. Not only is grace, is salvation by grace through faith, unconditional love on the part of God to sinners, agape love. Discipleship is an unconditional commitment on the part of the follower to his master, to his Savior. And he's pressing that here. And it ought to cause all of us, when we read these passages, let them stand and say what they say, to ask, do I really think like Jesus thinks? Then he goes on in this passage, of course you're familiar with it, which of you desiring to build a tower does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it, otherwise when he's laid a foundation is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. What he's saying is that one of the worst things that can happen is for a person to pretend he wants to follow Jesus, and then at some point along the way determine that following Jesus is too costly. So he's laying down here in these last months of his ministry the costliness of following him. Or what king, verse 31, going out to encounter another king in war, will not sit down first and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet far away, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. I would submit to you that in the West, there's a lot of church members, a lot of professing Christians, not a lot of Christ followers as Jesus defines the terms. This is how you can have an episode like we cited this morning from Matthew 7, when many at the day of judgment will say, but Lord, I've told you that we taught that passage before. Just to remind you, though, if you were to break down the Greek in that, every appeal begins, in your name we did this. In your name we prophesied. In your name we cast out demons. In your name we did mighty works. The appeal is, but Lord, everything we did was in your name. You learn from that passage and other passages that there's things that can be done in the name of the Lord that are not done to the glory of God, that do not constitute evangelical obedience to the Savior. And it causes anyone who would be a serious follower of Jesus Christ to stop and say, am I holding on to anything? Have I maybe not even vocalized, but is there somewhere in the recesses of my life that I've said, I'll follow Jesus as long as, I'll follow Jesus but, I'll give Jesus everything but? Because it's at the point of that exception that Jesus would say, if you've not renounced that, if you've not surrendered that, you cannot be my disciple. And then he finishes this passage by saying, salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? Salt as an agent, salt as a spice, if you please, as a preservative, is good, but salt that doesn't taste like salt is worthless. It's of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. Pretty graphic language from our Savior. It's thrown away. And then he says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Will you receive what I'm saying? Jesus said. Now, I want us to move forward. We want to talk about thinking like Jesus. If we're going to think like Jesus, the first thing we recognize is that salvation is His work. Everything He said in verse 31 that we read a while ago from Mark 8, He had to do it. He had to suffer, be rejected, killed, rise again. But we, when we appeal to sinners to come to Christ, we're not appealing to them to finish what Jesus started. We're not appealing to them to make complete or meaningful what Jesus did. We're appealing to them for the good of their own souls to surrender their lives to Christ. That's how we begin to think like Jesus. Now I would say in this place, with the history that Bethel has of good teaching and preaching in years past, that shouldn't even be an issue, really. That ought to be understood. We go over aspects of this with everyone who applies for membership, have been doing that for 11 years now. You see, Jesus didn't have an option to avoid the cross. And so when Peter suggests another way, this is what prompts the strong rebuke, "Get behind me, Satan." Jesus did not come with a multiplicity of plans to see which one worked. He came with plan A. He came to die. We need to learn that, by the way, as disciples. That the mission that we've been called to is bigger than ourselves, bigger than our personal matters, even our personal desires. And so Jesus wanted to teach this. He spoke plainly. You can appreciate Peter when you reflect upon how he responded to that. I mean, he's just become convinced that they've found the Messiah. People have been looking for the Messiah hundreds of years in Judaism. He has found Him. He's convinced of that. He has conviction about it. He makes the declaration. And the first thing Jesus teaches is that He's going to die. Where Peter was at that time, he could not think through, process how would that accomplish the long-awaited anticipation of the coming of Messiah to bring what the people of God needed. So thinking like Jesus. Jesus accuses Peter of having a wrong mindset, setting his mind on man's interest rather than God's interest. When God speaks through His word and says, "Must, the Son of Man must," then our response is to set our minds on what that will looks like, what that must looks like, regardless of how we feel about it. Mean a lot of things, but it will certainly mean denying our preferences, denying even our feelings about certain things, and coming to embrace His musts. So thinking like Jesus concerning these musts in the ministry is essential to success as Christ followers. There'll be temptations to drift away. There'll be temptations to get caught up in a lot of things that are good, but are not the best. And Jesus was teaching here, and He taught throughout the Gospels, if you put these lenses on, that right thinking about His ministry means staying true to what must be done. Those things that are of divine necessity. We've been going through those when we looked at different stages, phases of His teaching on disciple making. Study of the Word, worship, witness, fellowship. The cross, both the cross Jesus dies on and the cross he invites us to bear. So if we're going to think like Jesus, and we intentionally do that, and we ask ourselves the question, we read this morning from J.I. Packer saying, I've taught myself to ask, would Paul agree with this? It's a good question. It's a part of learning to think like Jesus. But that leads to acting like Jesus. Now I think it's why he moves, what we just read to you a while ago, why he moves from rebuking Peter, who was not thinking kingdom thoughts, thinking along kingdom lines, to calling upon the people to act. You see, I think in the West particularly, there are people who like the idea of being identified with, as a Christian. I've said to you before, said on Sunday mornings as we're going through this study of the coming persecution, that when it gets hot, multitudes who've been content to be identified as Christians are going to bail from churches. I don't think that's true here. But in plenty of places, that's going to happen because they did not come on board for it to cost anything. They came on board for benefit and for crying out loud. Listen to, I don't want to be unkind here, so I won't call names, but think about some of the arenas. One in southeast Texas. It's huge. The preacher there boasts that Muslims are very comfortable being there. Not such who were Muslims, like we talked about this morning. People who currently. And thousands, multiplied, scores of thousands of people fill that place. But a day is coming when the freeness of grace is going to be matched with the costliness of discipleship. And I promise you, those kind of venues are going to empty out because they've strictly been drawn by benefit, by having their best life now, by getting everything they want in life. That's the pitch. And that's so contrary to Jesus' teaching. Thinking like Jesus means we will, as followers of Jesus Christ, not necessarily say to the person we're sharing the gospel with, Jesus waited a while, but to say to one another, to remind ourselves, it costs something to be a follower of Christ. It's costly. It's what Bonhoeffer, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, called costly discipleship. In fact, he uses an encouraging word when we go back and look. If anyone would come after me, doesn't say if the elite, the hardy, the tough, folks who can stick it out, if anyone would come after me. This invitation shows that discipleship is potentially for everyone, but it has its costs. We don't need to go into detail, just simply to remind you, the core of the Great Commission, That command hiding in plain sight, is to make disciples. To do so out of those who are willing to engage in a true commitment to Jesus Christ. For Jesus, in the immediate context of the whole discussion of deny yourself, he's focusing on the importance of renouncing self as the center of our life and actions. In other words, self-denial is the decision of each of his followers to give over to God his or her body, career, money, and time. A true disciple, I came across this, I thought this was good. A true disciple is willing to shift the spiritual center of gravity in his or her life. And then here was a good definition I found. Self-denial is a sustained willingness to say no to self so that we can say yes to God. A sustained willingness. In other words, over and over, not occasional, not when it's convenient, a sustained willingness to say no to self so that we can say yes to God. Who recognizes the name Richard Wurmbrand? Wurmbrand, W-U-R-M-B-R-A-N-D. I'm not saying it clearly, you'd recognize it. He is the founder of Voice of the Martyrs. He spent 14 years in communist prisons, including 3 years in solitary confinement, 30 feet below ground level. And here's how he described his wretched condition of being cold, hungry, and in tattered rags. Now, 14 years in communist prison, 3 years of that, 30 feet underground in isolation. Here's a quote from him. "They broke 4 vertebrae in my back and many other bones. They carved me in a dozen places." In other words, they cut him. "They burned and cut 18 holes in my body. Yet alone in my cell, I danced for joy every night. I discovered a beauty in Christ that I had not known before." Folks, that's humbling to me just to read that. It's very much the Apostle Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 31. "I die every day," he said. So whether it's Paul in prison, Christ in Gethsemane, or you facing pressure in your own spiritual testing ground, self-denial is the willingness to say no to yourself so that you can say yes to God. If a Jew had seen someone with a cross on his shoulder, he would know that that person was preparing to die. He would know that once that cross had been picked up and placed on his shoulder, there was no turning back. The cross is not some personal hardship. This was some examples that I read about: a bossy in-law, a loud neighbor, a daily traffic jam. A cross represents something more. It's a symbol of mission. It's the essence of purpose. Something Jesus said he must do. He had a magnificent obsession. That's what I've told you as we've been going through Mark. I hope you picked up on the very language Mark used. It's almost as if Mark shows that Jesus was in a hurry to get to the cross. He did not bypass anything he came to do. He prepared the 12 so that when he could pray in the garden in John 17, the high priestly prayer, "I've finished the work you gave me to do." He had prepared them. Was ready to leave them. But there is a focus in Mark's gospel. Next, immediately, then, he's moving to the cross. So, when we take that, we need to learn that whatever mission God gives to me or gives to you is my cross. It is your cross. If it's filled with joy, enjoy it. If it's filled with hardship, embrace it. Endure it. Taking up my cross means giving up many of my rights. Determined to see it through, ready to die for it. Ready to live through it. No turning back. No turning back. I've given you this quote before, but it seemed appropriate again tonight. For this, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his book Cost of Discipleship, said, "When Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. There's a story told, and I came across this, of a soldier who served under the Greek general Antigonus. The soldier had a disease that was extremely painful and could at any time destroy his life. So in every campaign, every battle, he was found at the forefront of the hottest battles. His pain prompted him to fight so as to forget. His expectation of death caused him to court death on the field. The general admired the bravery of this soldier so much that he had a renowned physician cure him of his malady. From that moment, the valiant soldier was no longer seen at the front. He avoided danger instead of seeking it and sought to protect his life instead of risking it on the field. And just as his tribulation had made him fight well, his health and comfort destroyed his usefulness as a soldier. He had taken back possession of his life. So it is with a disciple of Jesus Christ. When we take back possession of our life and the control of our life, our effectiveness for Christ drops drastically. So this one writer I read said this about the idea of taking up your cross. And don't let anything get in the way of following Christ. Not boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife, children, job, education, sports, hunting, fishing, bowling, hobbies, food, drink, house, vacations, or anything else. I continue to be amazed in 40 years of ministry as I watch young families. And the message they seem to send to their children is being found in divine worship on Sunday morning is an important thing unless something else more important comes along. And the message that they're sending their children unwittingly is damning to the souls of their children. So they say to their children essentially, what we do during the week, we've got to get up, got to get out the door, we've got to be at school at 8 o'clock, come Gehenna or high water. But Sunday morning, if we get there late, don't make it at all, it's a damning message. Well, it's soccer season. We'll be there unless our kids win the games on Saturday, so they have to play on Sunday. You can just fill in the blank. The message that I see too many parents, young parents, saying, if not explicitly to their children, at least by example, is being present for divine worship and divine study on the Lord's Day is a good thing to do unless something more important comes along. And I promise you, folks, that mentality will not raise a generation of disciples like we're talking about here. One other thing before we wrap up here. If we're going to follow Jesus, we're going to think like Jesus, we're going to act like Jesus, we also need to learn to invest like Jesus. Listening to one fellow some time back, and he talked about time and money, and he said that money is silver and time is gold. And people have made money, lost money, and made money again. But time you can't get back. Once you spend time, it's spent. God gave us one life to spend, not save. Investing, as Jesus said earlier in Mark 8:35, whoever would save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. Investment refers to the wise expenditure of one's life. Here's the question we have to ask ourselves as disciple makers, as people who want to be disciple makers. In whose lives are we investing? For us to spare ourselves inconvenience, uncomfortableness, is to be in the action of saving when Jesus calls us to invest. In fact, one writer that I was reading came, I thought he made this keen observation. He said there's this whole self-help movement. And the genesis of it, he says, is traced to Abraham Maslow. You recognize Maslow, anybody? Listen to this. His doctrine of self-actualization. Maslow's theory is built on what he calls a hierarchy of needs. You may have heard that term. It says one of the most fundamental needs are physical ones, such as food and shelter. The second tier of needs includes security needs, such as income and family. The third segment is love, and the fourth is purpose. And according to Maslow's theory, only when these four layers of needs are met can a person be self-actualized, reaching his or her full potential. If you're familiar with the human potential movement and all that, it anchors itself right in this. But when you look at that, the notion of self-actualization, it seems enticing. It seems to even make sense at some level. Well, we need food, we need clothing, we need shelter. But Jesus comes in teaching on discipleship and the cost of discipleship, and he turns it upside down. He advocating losing yourself, that only by doing that can you find yourself. It's the higher way. It's the harder way. Jesus rejected the notion of self-centeredness. He said no to self so that he could say yes to his Father and pick up his cross. He invested his life in other men's souls, the most precious commodity on the face of the earth, for souls are eternal. And Jesus is asking all of those who follow him to make a similar investment. It'll cost us something. Salvation costs nothing, but discipleship costs everything. Someone told about Charlemagne. You may remember Charlemagne who tried to bring the Roman Empire back together. His goal in life was to rule the world. They discovered his grave. They found his skeleton seated on the throne. They would have these big, big mausoleums they would build for these fellows. When I was in China, we looked at the terracotta warrior exhibit. One of the emperors of China had, before he died, it had this massive underground tomb built. He had the artisans build thousands and thousands of these life-size warriors. Some of them appeared to be marching. Some were archers. Some were in chariots with horses. Thousands of them. We got to move among some of that very carefully in China. So what happened was a farmer's son was out digging one day, and he dug a hole, and he fell through into this place. You may have read about it. It's in Xi'an, China, the Terracotta Warrior exhibit. And what had happened was when this emperor was approaching death, he had all this done. And the artisans who had been doing all this secretly, once he was buried there, and by the way, his wives and concubines were buried with him, though they didn't have the liberty of having died of natural causes, there were rivers in there of quicksilver running. It's unbelievable. Well, but he had all the artisans by another group of people slaughtered, so none would live to tell where it was. He had an army for the afterlife. So he had these huge tombs. Well, Charlemagne had a tomb like that. When his grave was discovered, they found his skeleton seated on the throne with his bony finger pointing to a verse in the Bible that was on his lap. It was Matthew 16:26. What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world yet forfeits his soul? Here's the question I want to ask you tonight as we get ready to leave. What will the ledger sheet read at the end of my life? How much is my soul worth? Is there anything in my life that is preventing me from investing myself fully in the harvesting of souls? Jesus was challenging his hearers then as he would challenge us now. Don't throw your lives away. It's John Piper's great little book. If you haven't read it, I encourage you to get it. Don't waste your life. He was saying, follow me, think like me, act like me, invest your lives like me, lose yourselves in me, and you'll find everything you could ever need. How are we investing? Now, I realize, folks, what we're talking about tonight is this is not pleasant words. This doesn't tickle anybody's ears. But I'll take you back to John chapter 6, verses 66 to 69 as we close. The great bread of life discourse. He had just taught things painful here. No one can come after me except the Father who sent me draws him. Verse 66, after this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. And Jesus said to them, do you want to go away as well? Here's what Peter said, and it needs to be our heart. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we've believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. In other words, another way of saying you're the Messiah. So this is why it's important as disciples who want to be disciple makers to be honest about the cost of discipleship. Let me tell you something. I've been doing this long enough and have encountered enough people from certain arenas in Christendom who've been promised nothing but blessing. They've heard preachers teach throughout the years, God doesn't want you to be sick. He doesn't want you to have any needs. His intent is for you to have everything, be healthy, wealthy, wise, have everything you need. Life, just like you can't imagine it. Your best life now. And I've watched these people crash and burn under such teaching. And I've had to minister to them through the years. And I don't even know what they're teaching now with what's on the horizon. I don't know how any man with a clear conscience can be teaching people today that it's just going to be hunky-dory. You're going to tiptoe through the tulips. I don't see how anybody's doing that with a clear conscience. The good news is that by God's grace, I never bought into that. What you're hearing me teach tonight is what I've been teaching for 40 years, perhaps ramped up a little bit. Let's tell people. Let's tell one another. Let's tell followers of Christ. Salvation is free. Discipleship is costly. If, by God's providence, they leave this earth not having paid the great price for discipleship, they will not resent you. But multitudes resent having been told everything's fine. Everything's going to be okay when it's not. It's going to be smooth sailing when it's not. The primary goal of our mission and ministry is to see souls saved. And if our discipleship does not include evangelism, then it doesn't deserve the name discipleship. So Jesus has brought his followers, and he brings us as we're studying his life, to the end of the come and be with me phase. God willing, next week, we'll begin taking a look, or at least the week following, I think, a look at the remain in me, abide in me, and see how he would have us to live in the light of that teaching and that relationship. Come and see. That was the first thing he said. Come and follow me, he said. Come and be with me. Next week he invites us to remain in him. I thank God that you're here. Thank God you've continued coming through the summer to this. I think it's very important that we understand this. May God bless your faithfulness in your life. May he give you souls. That's what I pray. When I pray about this group and this ministry, Lord, give souls to these men and women. Let them see someone brought to faith in Christ. And in that experience, let them then be the nurturers who help lead that person to become himself or herself a disciple maker. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we bow before you now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, help us to understand, help us to realize that while salvation is free, discipleship is costly. Help us to check our own thoughts, to take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ so that we think like Jesus, and our thinking like Jesus leads us to act like Jesus. And as we think and act like Jesus, then we invest like Him. We see His example. He invested Himself in the 12. God, give to these brothers and sisters someone in whose life they can invest themselves. Help us to be faithful to remind one another. Following Jesus is about denying self, cross-bearing, all the way to the end. And then come in this place and give us a harvest of souls, we pray, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Let's talk just a few minutes before.